man who lived over 2,400 years ago understood characters better than many modern writers. For writers beginning to think pro and converting from a hobby writer to a professional writer, the ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle seems like a wrong turn, especially when we're looking at characters. Geez, what could he possibly know? I mean, Aristotle is over 2,000 years old, really old, decrepit. What on earth can someone so old tell us about story? We grew up with movies and TVs. We have computers. We drive cars. He had a banging chariot and scratched on something called papyrus. He didn't even have good paper and ink. What does he know? That was my process, at least. I've learned better. We all can. Welcome to The Right Focus, a podcast for writers at all levels, headed up by M.A. Lee, with the assistance of Remy Black and Edie Runes, all from Writers, Inc. Books. Our focus is productivity, process, craft, and tools. Show notes for this and other episodes can be found on therightfocus.blogspot.com. Write to us at books@aol.com. Our podcast episodes last as long as it takes to fix a quick dinner, drive a short commute, or take a brisk walk. We're bookcasting with Think Like a Pro by M.A. Lee, copyright 2017, revised 2018. Today, we start the fourth chapter, One Ancient Greek. He is our foundation for everything we understand about characters and a good bit more. Who is Aristotle? The teacher in me promises to be brief. Have you heard of Alexander the Great? Aristotle taught him. Plato taught Aristotle. Socrates taught Plato. Socrates lived at the time of the three great Greek dramatists. So Aristotle grew up hearing about these three and debated at Plato's Academy with other students on how these three were great and what made them so great. Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, by the way, are called the three greatest philosophers who ever lived. Socrates challenged our thought processes. He famously said, "I only know that I know nothing," basically telling us doubt leads to knowledge. Plato challenged our view of the world. He told us to question what we think is reality and remember that what we think is solid importance is merely shadows. Aristotle challenged everything. We have to learn not to reinvent the wheel. I've learned from those who have gone before, which is the theme for this chapter 4. And Aristotle? Why is he important? Well, he was one of the very first people to look at writing, to learn about writing. And that old geeky Greek was smart. Aristotle examined successful dramas in order to discover the reason they were so successful. Those dramas had certain commonalities, which are the reason those ancient dramas still grip our modern hearts. Over and over, these stories resonate with people in many different places at many different times. Great stories are composed by great storytellers, and that's what Aristotle studied. He was the first, and everyone since him has merely worked on the foundation he built. What did the commonalities have in common? They reveal character, heart, personality, motivation, behavior. Real writers try so hard to do as we strive to become great storytellers. He understood. Okay, let's get to the heart of it. Aristotle views any story's plot from a dramatic standpoint. He didn't initiate this dramatic plot structure. Instead, he analyzed the best plays, selecting from the best of the best, which were written two and three generations before his life. The best dramatist for Aristotle, and still recognized as the best in all drama of classical antiquity, were the three award-winning masters Sophocles, Euripides, and Aeschylus. Their intuitive understanding of the five essentials for great story came just as strongly over 2,000 years later. While their plays were taken from ancient myth, they weren't telling the stories. They were focused on the people in crisis. People in crisis reveal their true selves, the essences of their personalities, with all the ugly motivations and cravings drive people like men and Antigone and Oedipus and Clytemnestra and Agamemnon. Flowing from the Greek dramatist's pens are horrible deeds driven by dark revenge, the worst of who we are, confronting the noblest that we can be. People in crisis create powerful suspense. Their motivations form strong speech and work out what has happened and what they must do. While the plays Medea and Antigone are memorable, they contain elements that gripped my heart every single time I taught them. Agony and ugly motivations are like evil imaginings until we see similar actions in modern society. To punish her husband who abandoned her, she kills her own children, along with a couple of other people. Today we read headlines about mothers who murder their children, like Susan Smith. Even as the tragedies present writhing evil, elements of the stories and in the comedies give us light and hope. Antigone has a noble cause and righteous anger on her side, and the audience roots anger on her side, and the audience roots for her, even as we know she takes an irrevocable step that will doom her. The power of these stories easily translates to characters who confront tragic events and rise above them to triumph rather than die. Some characters reach their destiny, not their doom. And Aristotle, centuries ago, discovered for us the basic essentials that are revelatory for characters. Although he didn't present his thesis in quite this manner, we can boil his insights into five essentials and five types of characters. Five essentials of structure are plot elements. They're actually requirements for character development through plot. These five open up the characters for the audience. To illustrate each essential, I'll use Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, a story that many adults worldwide are familiar with. And stay with me. Don't let weird words weird you out. Mimesis is the first essential structure. The story must imitate life. Stories improve when people behave as they reasonably would, even in fantastical scenarios and settings. Mythical tropes should follow that trope or explain clearly the reason for any change. Vampires who sparkle in daylight would be more logical if the reason they can enter sunlight, even the dulled sun of the Pacific Northwest in rainy season, is their vegetarianism. To most adults, looking at the story Romeo and Juliet, they think it couldn't possibly happen. Yet the daily news provides us constant examples of two lovers at cross purposes. Modern updates to the tragedy of the Montagues and the Capulets place the story in a conflict of ethnicity, such as West Side Story, or religion, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, or economic disparity, as in Atonement. Shakespeare builds his families as similar, both alike in dignity, it says in the prologue to Act 1, that these families are focused on monetary gain. Whoever marries her will have the chinks, it says in Act 1. The original event may have been a business deal gone wrong between the two families. Whatever the inciting event, conflict occurs and continues to occur. People gossip about such fights all the time. Are the primary characters imitations of life, as Aristotle requires? Juliet is the young, obedient daughter who finally encounters someone she wants more than she wants to be obedient. She and Romeo speak the same language. Look at their conversation as they dance. Both speak of prayer and pilgrims and holy kisses. In the balcony scene, Juliet admits their love is too rash, too unadvised, too sudden, too like the lightning which doth cease to be ere one can say it lightens. She is applying logic to love, yet love isn't logical. Romeo is a little older than Juliet, yet not much more. He's enough in the world that he recognizes how rare their connection is. Beauty alone does not attract him. Their conversation while dancing proves their compatibility. He understands he's courting danger, yet like Juliet, he has encountered someone worth the risk. Both young lovers have extreme reactions. This is typical of fallacious teenaged thinking. One, teenagers think, no one has ever felt this way before. We're unique. Two, doing something secretly adds to the excitement. Three, waiting and patience are for fuddy-duddies. Four, the world ends when they can't get what they want. Separation is death, teenagers think. Five, conflict with parents and others is to be avoided at all cost. Secrets are better. And the sixth wrong thinking that teenagers do, just like Romeo and Juliet, is barriers require extreme measures to overcome. While a seasoned person will find a way around any barricade, and accept conflict as necessary to achieve a great goal, teenagers cry doom and die. Yes, indeed, Shakespeare has appropriately imitated teenage life. The next Greek word is peripeteia, P-E-R-I-P-E-T-E-I-A, which means falling around, and it represents the unexpected or irony. Life is filled with ironies. A story will not have mimesis if it limits ironic circumstances. Briefly and succinctly, irony is the difference between what is expected and what actually occurs. The three primary types are verbal, saying one thing while meaning another, with the Southernism, bless her heart, as an example, when the exact opposite is meant. Don't you look pretty? When an ink mark crosses the face is an obvious example. Sarcasm is not an exact synonym of verbal irony. The heavy mockery of sarcasm is intended to ridicule. The second type of irony is situational. Actions that cause an unintended or unexpected effect. This is not coincidence. Just married and anticipating only good things to happen, Romeo in 10 short minutes causes the death of his best friend Mercutio and deliberately murders Tybalt. These events are the unintended and unexpected conclusion to Tybalt's challenge of Romeo in Act 3. Juliet tries to return to her father's goodwill by saying she will obey him, only to have him move up her marriage to Count Paris in Act 4. Third is dramatic irony. In this irony, the audience knows information that the characters do not. The audience sees Juliet's mother approaching as the two newlyweds say goodbye. We know that Juliet is not really dead, while Romeo does not. We know that she is on the verge of waking up. Her colors are returning. Romeo even says, "Thy lips are warm," and we want to cry, "Wait," as he commits suicide. Hamartia, and a little subheading of it called hubris. Hamartia is the fatal flaw leading to the protagonist's downfall. Most modern character development templates mention a character's weakness. Indiana Jones's fear of snakes is legendary. Raiders of the Lost Ark uses this fear effectively. We are introduced to it early. With a snake in the seat of the airplane as it takes off from the river in the South American jungle. That fear becomes suspenseful when Indy encounters the hundreds of snakes in the Egyptian tomb. Fear, however, is insufficient as a fatal flaw. A fatal flaw for a character should be a mistaken way of thinking. Harry Potter in J.K. Rowling's series invariably thinks that he can handle a problem by himself. Time and time again, he discovers that he needs Hermione and Ron. Romeo's fatal flaw is his violent emotions. His love is too extreme. He cannot contemplate life without Juliet. His plans are too extreme. Rather than enlisting Prince Aeschylus as the mediator of a marriage that can end the feud, Romeo plots a secret marriage. Romeo's anger is too extreme. He murders Tybalt when just 15 minutes prior he was refusing to accept a challenge to a duel. Juliet's fatal flaw is her dependence on others. She is the obedient daughter, wholly dependent on her parents. She falls in with her plans for her future until she meets Romeo. She is then dependent on Romeo's plan for their marriage. Finally, she is dependent on Friar Lawrence's plan to avoid her coming marriage to Count Paris. A special kind of hamartia is hubris. In ancient Greek, this was pride that challenges fate or the gods or circumstance. Not all hamartia is hubris, but all hubris is hamartia. Hubris occurs when someone believes that they can do no wrong. They are equal to the gods. Part of the reason Aristotle insists Cicero must fall from a great height. The other part of hubris relates to the vulture-like drive in all humans to relish and feed on others' great misery. Watch how drivers and passengers peer so closely when they pass a car wreck. Students encircle two arguing peers in the school corridor. With most genre stories, the protagonist will have weaknesses and even tainting secrets, yet lack the doom-creating hubris. However, the antagonist or other characters can certainly have weaknesses, secrets, and hubris. Romeo says, right before his marriage to Juliet, "Love devouring death, do what he dare, it is enough, I may but call her mine." Of course, an hour later, after Mercutio and Tybalt are dead, he realizes, "I am fortune's fool," in Act 3. He dared death took the dare, and came out the winner. The protagonist may have arrogance, hubris, in thinking an extreme danger to a relationship, to a community, or to advancement will not happen to them, or she or he will be blind to circumstances, hamartia, that create the extreme danger. The next essential is catastrophe. That great height from which a character falls increases catastrophe. This disaster must be one from which no recovery seems possible. Fiction, with its triumph over the conflict, an ordeal is necessary. The only difference between Oedipus or Macbeth with a modern protagonist is, well, there is no real difference when you think about it. Romeo's banishment does not seem like a horrible event. After all, Prince Aeschylus showed mercy. He could have executed Romeo, as he had decreed he would execute the next fighters, way back in Act 1. However, both Romeo and Juliet consider banishment as equal to death, and they threaten suicide. Juliet's supposed death becomes a suicidal catastrophe for Romeo. As soon as he hears about it, he schemes a method to kill himself. His suicide upon Juliet's moment of awakening becomes her catastrophe. Romeo and Juliet is often classified as a pathetic tragedy, since the action of neither protagonist bring about their doom. They are driven to their deaths more by the ticking of a clock than by their own actions. Yet Shakespeare has created two juveniles who consider no other recourse for their love except an extreme one. He has carefully crafted the violent delights which lead to violent ends. Then Shakespeare takes his catastrophe one step further. Romeo's banishment and subsequent suicide lead to the death of his mother. Only his father remains alive, and the name and the house will die with him. Juliet's family is in a similar case, for the cousin Tybalt is now dead, and her father is played as an old man, broken by the end of the play, with little more to drive him forward. Prince Aeschylus's relative, Count Paris, is also dead. The feud between the two families has widespread disaster. Only Benvolio is absent at the end of the play. And where is Benvolio at the end of the play? Did he travel to Mantua with Romeo? Was he left behind when Romeo returned to Verona? Did he succumb to infection from the wound he received in the opening street fight between the Montagues and the Capulets? The audience is given no clues. Benvolio is gone, just as the two families are now gone. Catharsis is defined as purging and cleansing. In story, it requires more than an emotional, heart-wrenching end. It must contain an intellectual acceptance by the audience, or the story has not achieved its purpose, according to Aristotle. The Latin poet Horace, centuries after Aristotle, redefined the closing purpose of catharsis as dulce et utile, sweetness and usefulness. The story should be sweet entertainment, even as it presents useful enlightenment. We, the audience and readers, need to know the suffering we endured with the characters had purpose. Suffering's purpose creates investment by the audience into our characters. Using dulce et utile deepens the story. With peripeteia, writers examine how the world turns against their main character. Hubris sees a doom of the protagonist's own making, even though he may not see that doom approaching. Throughout Romeo and Juliet, Friar Lawrence warns that violent delights lead to violent ends. Shakespeare is not telling a love story. He is explaining how good reason can be overcome by emotions. Even the voice of reason, the friar, is overcome by fear in the last act. He could have intervened if he had been on time. We may be unhappy with the ending of the play, but we should be accepting of it. Thus, we, the audience, have three lessons. Lessons we are still trying to learn today. Use reason first. Moderate all emotions. Intervene on time. Don't hesitate. We see many more lessons as well. And once we understand these lessons, we can accept the deaths in Shakespeare's tragedy. Romeo, Juliet, Mercutio, Tybalt, Lady Montague, and Count Paris. Six dead, and maybe Benvolio, who makes seven. Catharsis is achieved. These essentials have purpose. While Aristotle focused for a successful culmination of the conflict, literary fiction is distinguished from genre fiction by that single word, successful. Yet even in non-tragic literary fiction, life as it was may be destroyed in order to allow a new birth of hope for the future. Without catastrophe and catharsis, the protagonist of hopeful literary fiction will not achieve their climb from disaster. Genre writers will discover that these five essentials still fit their mysteries or action adventures or romances. A character fulfilling his destiny will face these five and overcome them, achieving the desired goal and being transformed in the journey. Keep Aristotle's five essentials at the forefront as you develop your primary characters and place them in your selected plot method. We'll have more on Aristotle through the essential characters next Wednesday. Until then, ride on.